This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Kingship of Self-Control, Individual Problems and Possibilities. Author: William George Jordon. Topic: The Kingship of Self-Control. In this chapter, we explore the profound concept of self-control as the key to unlocking human potential and achieving mastery over oneself. Man, endowed with remarkable powers by both God and himself, holds the reins to shape his destiny and realize his fullest potential. The dichotomy between attributing failure to fate and claiming success as the result of self-made efforts underscores the pivotal role of self-control in determining one's trajectory in life. Man enters the world as a possibility, with his greatest adversary being himself. Whether he becomes a victim or a victor hinges largely on his ability to exercise self-control. To realize the magnificence of his potential, man must retreat into the solitude of spiritual contemplation, akin to Christ's solitude in the garden, to acknowledge his divine significance as an individual. With a purified mind and renewed vigor, he can confront life's challenges with resilience and determination. Man's theology should emphasize his greatness as a human soul with extraordinary potential, empowering him to achieve mastery through self-discipline. The power of self-control distinguishes him from lower animals, enabling him to engage in moral struggles and achieve moral victories. Every advancement in the progress of the world represents a new form of control, transcending the dominance of circumstances and gaining mastery over them. However, the most significant form of control is self-control, which determines whether man is a sovereign or a captive in every moment of his existence. Instead of envying the success of others, man should emulate the processes that led to their triumphs, recognizing the transformative power of self-discipline in shaping one's destiny. Success emerges from humble beginnings through prolonged and incremental efforts, akin to an installment plan of development and growth. And has two creators, God and himself. The first creator furnishes him with the essential elements of his life and the guidelines to mold it according to his wishes. His second creator, himself, possesses remarkable powers that he often fails to recognize. It is what a man makes of himself that truly matters. When a man fails in life, he often attributes it to fate, saying, "I am as God made me." However, when he succeeds, he proudly declares himself a self-made man. Man enters this world not as a finished product, but as a possibility. His greatest adversary is himself. In his weakness, he becomes a product of circumstances. In his strength, he becomes the master of circumstances. Whether he becomes a victim or a victor largely depends on himself. A man is not truly great solely for what he is, but rather for what he has the potential to become. Until he fully grasps the magnificence of his potential, until he realizes his responsibility to live the life entrusted to him as an individual, he merely drifts through existence. To envision his life as it could be, a man must retreat alone into the mountains of spiritual contemplation, akin to Christ's solitude in the garden, seeking strength to navigate the world. There, he must inhale the fresh, pure air of acknowledging his divine significance as an individual. With a purified mind and renewed vigor, he can then confront the challenges of daily life. Man requires less of the notion that he is a feeble creature of the earth in his theology, and more of the understanding that he is a great human soul with extraordinary potential as a fundamental aspect of his daily faith. With this expanded and invigorating perspective on life, he realizes that he can achieve mastery through self-discipline. The self-control exemplified in the most notable moments in history and in the simplest aspects of everyday life is fundamentally the same, differing only in degree. This level of control is attainable to man if he is willing to pay the price. The power of self-control is one of the distinguishing qualities that sets man apart from lower animals. He is the only creature capable of engaging in moral struggles and achieving moral victories. Every advancement in the progress of the world represents a new form of control. It involves transcending the dominance of a fact and gaining understanding and mastery over it. For centuries, humanity viewed lightning with fear. Today, we comprehend it as electricity, a force we have harnessed and made subservient to us. The various innovations in electricity are mere demonstrations of our control over this potent force. However, the most significant form of control is self-control. At every moment of his existence, man is either a sovereign or a captive. When he succumbs to wrongful desires, to any human frailty, when he falls into hopeless submission to any circumstance, environment, or failure, he becomes a slave. But when he consistently overcomes human weaknesses, conquers internal opposition, and continuously forges a new self from the errors and foolishness of his past, then he is a ruler. He reigns wisely over himself. Alexander conquered the entire world, except for himself. Despite being the emperor of the earth, he remained enslaved to his own passions. We often gaze upon the possessions of others with envy, wishing they were ours. Sometimes this desire is fleeting and unrealistic, such as when we wish for Queen Victoria's crown or Emperor William's self-assurance. Other times it grows into bitterness, as we lament the perceived unfairness of life's distribution of blessings, only to resign ourselves fatalistically to our circumstances. Instead of envying the success of others, we should strive to emulate the processes that led to their triumphs. We admire the physical prowess of Sandow, forgetting that he was once a weak babe and child, with little hope for survival. We may envy the spiritual strength of someone like Paul, without recognizing the transformation from the weak Saul of Tarsus that occurred through his self-discipline. We often ignore the thousands of instances of success in the world, whether mental, moral, physical, financial, or spiritual, where the ultimate triumph emerged from beginnings far weaker and humbler than our own. Any individual can achieve self-control if they are willing to commit to it. However, they should not anticipate obtaining it without making prolonged and incremental efforts. Nature operates on the principle of installment plans when dealing with individuals. No one is so impoverished that they cannot begin paying for what they desire. Each small contribution made by an individual is stored and accumulated by nature as a reserve fund for times of need. The patience a person exhibits in enduring the minor trials of daily life is stored by nature as a remarkable reserve for moments of crisis. Every mental, physical, or moral energy expended by a person in righteous actions is stored and transformed into strength. Nature does not accept a one-time payment for anything. This would be unfair to the poor and the weak. Instead, nature recognizes only the gradual installment plan of development and growth. Habits cannot be formed or broken instantaneously. They require time and effort. However, at any given moment, an individual can begin cultivating or dismantling a habit. This perspective on character development should inspire those who genuinely aspire to live up to their full potential. Self-control can be cultivated in the same way as strengthening a weak muscle, through consistent daily exercises. As part of moral gymnastics, individuals should perform daily acts that are unpleasant, but contribute to instant action during times of need. These exercises can be simple, such as putting down an engrossing book at a thrilling moment. Getting out of bed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.